Very good evening, guys. Now, are you able to see my screen? I've shared the screen. Are you able to see my screen? Very good evening, Mansi, and good evening to Chakri. Good evening to all of you. So now I think it's clear. So I'll not be taking your classes. I'm just going to do MCQ practice to all of you. So I don't think so. I'm taking your classes on the Arise platform. So let's start. Whatever time given to me and whatever time I have with you all, I want to use it at its best. So now, not wasting time, we will start with the MCQ session pertaining to the clinical based MCQs. Okay. During diagnostic laparoscopy, so I'm starting with the question. During diagnostic laparoscopy, a 28-year-old female for chronic pelvic pain, you noticed inflammation of the liver capsule and adjacent peritoneum. What is the most likely causative organism during diagnostic laparoscopy? You notice in a 28-year-old female, you notice a chronic pelvic pain. There is an inflammation of the liver capsule and adjacent peritoneum. What is the most likely causative organism? Calimetobacterium granulomatosis, Chlamydia trachomatis, Haemophilus ducreyi, HSV type 2. Excellent, Sessi Murugan, you're correct. This is Chlamydia trachomatis. Can you be more precise which Chlamydia trachomatis is associated with the inflammation near the liver capsule? And what is that called as? So it is mainly Chlamydia trachomatis D2K. It's mainly Chlamydia trachomatis D2K. And what is this called as? What is this syndrome called as? So this syndrome is called as Fitz-Hugh-Curtis syndrome, perihepatic adhesions post-infection with chlamydia and gonococci leading to chronic pain. It's not actually, chronic pelvic pain is due to PID, but inflammation of the liver capsule and perihepatic adhesions leading to violent string appearance. This is called as Fitz-Hugh-Curtis syndrome. It's not A2K, it is D2K. ABC, Chlamydia trachomatis ABC mainly cause the trachoma of the eyes. Chlamydia trachomatis ABC mainly cause the trachoma of the eye. D2K causes Fitz-Hugh-Curtis syndrome. Whereas Chlamydia trachomatis L1, L2, L3 causes lymphogranuloma venerum. Let's see the next question. This is something very similar to what you got in FMG 2020. Okay. A 20-year-old pregnant woman presented to the genitourinary medicine clinic with anogenital warts. She is diagnosed with human papilloma virus infection type 11. What are the HPV types which can lead to the genital warts? Mainly HPV 6 and 11. To be more precise, it is 6 which causes more warts than 11. When HPV causes genital warts, we call them as condyloma acuminata. Condyloma acuminata. Condyloma acuminata. Picture was given as an image-based question for you in FMG 2020. Condyloma acuminata. Picture was given as an image-based question for FMG 2020. At the end of the session, I'll definitely show you the picture of condyloma acuminata. Okay? Gautam, what does 16 and 18 do? What do HPV 16 and 18 do? HPV 16 and 18 are mainly highly carcinogenic and they cause serious cervix. As anyway, we are speaking about HPVs. Let me first speak about HPVs, okay? HPV 6 and 11 causes genital warts. HPV 16 and 18 causes CA cervix. Among this, HPV 16 is most commonly associated with CA cervix. Whereas HPV 18 is most specific. HPV 18 is most specific. HPV 16 is associated with squamous cell carcinoma of cervix. HPV 18 is associated with adenocarcinoma of the cervix. HPV 31 and 33 are associated with CINs, cervical intraepithelial neoplasia. Okay. All these are single liners pertaining to HPV. Can anybody tell, can I prevent warts? Can I prevent warts? Can I prevent warts, CA cervix, and CA vulva? See, these warts are nothing but a pre-malignant lesions of the vulva. So how can I prevent warts? How can I prevent CA cervix? How can I prevent CA vulva? How can I prevent CA vagina? Excellent. We can prevent. By giving what we can prevent? Very good, Shashi Murugan. So you can prevent these by giving vaccine. And what is the vaccine which is available? It is Gardasil. Gardasil and Gardasil 9 are best for preventing all these. They prevent the pre-malignant lesions and malignancy of cervix, vulva, vagina. Okay? Gardasil is against HPV 16, 18, 6 and 11. Whereas Gardasil 9 is 16, 18, 6, 11, 31, 33, 45, 52, 58. Did I write line? Yes. So if I have to give to any of my patient, what do you think, which one I should give? Gardasil or Gardasil 9? If I'm giving to my patient, which one I'll advise? I'll advise Gardasil 9, no? See, because we always prefer to get the best. So I would advise Gardasil 9 over Gardasil. Now guys, one more thing I would like to ask you. I'll give only the woman who comes to me, even her boyfriend. I think we should ideally give it before the act of coitus. And you should give both for male as well as female. So actually according to ACOG, American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology, they give between 11 to 13 years, both. Actually, everything else is same for both. So we ideally give between 11 to 13 years in their vaccination schedule, not ours. In India, we are like at least take between 9 to 26 years. Manu, now I get some auntie. You know, somebody has told her there is a vaccine for CA cervix. And she has very enthusiastically come to me around 40 years. Doctor, I want to take the vaccine. Can I give the vaccine to her or I should not give the vaccine? 40-year-old lady came to you for Gardasil, Gardasil 9. Will you give vaccine or will you send the patient and lose the... Yes, both boys and girls will give. Because boys are the one which are introducing HPVs into girls, right? So you have to eradicate from both of them. No. So will you send her? You lose one patient, no, if you send her. Something is always better than nothing. We always learn this, no? So it can be given. Obviously, efficacy decreases. Post-coitus efficacy decreases. Somewhere we have the chance of HPV. But still, it helps in reducing the chance of CA cervix in a little way. So you can give up to 40 years. And it is contraindicated in pregnancy. It's given 0.5 ml injection IM. Little old is Cervarix. Cervarix is not much used nowadays. Cervarix is only against HPV 16 and 18. It is only for girls. We don't prefer giving Cervarix much now. We mainly give Gardasil or Gardasil 9. Okay. So I hope you're all clear. You can give it till 40 years. It's recently released as a guideline also. Okay, let's go back to the question. So she has condyloma acuminata. What is the management of condyloma acuminata in a pregnant female? 5-fluorouracil, cryotherapy, imiquinamide, podophyllin. Yes, guys, what is your answer? Excellent, Shashi. So the answer here is cryotherapy. The answer here is cryotherapy. So when you have a 20-year-old pregnant woman with anogenital warts, pregnancy may be avoid 5-fluorouracil, imiquinamide and podophyllin. Non-pregnant patients, you can give 5-fluorouracil, imiquinamide and podophyllin. But in pregnancy, we avoid... these drugs, and in pregnancy, the drugs which we use is you can either do surgery cryotherapy where with liquid nitrous oxide or carbon dioxide you coagulate this condyloma, or you can give trichloroacetic acid, or you can give trichloroacetic acid. Okay. Next question. I think we have this question. Right. A 36-year-old woman is complaining of having heavy menstrual bleeding for 2 years. Heavy menstrual bleeding for 2 years. Abdominal examination reveals a 20-week size uterus, and her pelvic scan shows multiple interstitial fibroids. Her hemoglobin is 9 gram per deciliter. She is nulliparous and wishes to preserve her fertility. What management option would you recommend? GnRH analog for 6 months followed by myomectomy. MRI focused ultrasonography. Open or laparoscopic myomectomy. Uliprostol acetate. Right, so I see the answer coming up as A. That is gonadotropin releasing analog for 6 months, followed by myomectomy. Okay, I would like to ask you one few questions here. Why are you avoiding the other three options? Tell me, why are you avoiding the other three options? What is the advantage of GnRH giving before myomectomy? Why can't we go for open or laparoscopic myomectomy? Why should we give prior 6 months of GnRH analogs? We did this already, no? I am feeling the same that we did this already, actually. Right. So you're correct. It is GnRH analogs for 6 months. That is because it helps in the reducing the size of the fibroid and vascularity of the fibroid. Okay, next question. A 48-year-old woman is complaining of abnormal uterine bleeding, which lasted for two years. She has tried the combined oral contraceptive pills, oral progestogens, tranexamic acid, and mefenamic acid, but without any improvement. Before I go further, we didn't do this question. I felt that previous question I did somewhere recently, but this I don't think so we did. Okay. So before I read any further question, I want you people to answer me one thing. When you have a 48-year-old with abnormal uterine bleeding, what is the first differential diagnosis which is striking in your brain, or what is your brain telling which one you have to rule out before I do anything further? Yes. What is the first differential diagnosis you would like to do? I would always answers and endometrial hyperplasias. Always remember this point. Whenever you have a perimenopausal woman or menopausal woman with bleeding, my brain tells I have to rule out endometrial cancers or endometrial hyperplasias. Okay. But do you know what is the most common cause of abnormal uterine bleeding in a perimenopausal woman? It is anovulatory cycles. While we are ending our menstruation, we don't have the proper ovulatory cycles. It is anovulatory cycles, and we all know that anovulatory cycles present you with irregular bleeding and heavy bleeding. She has tried everything now. She has tried hormonal therapy with OCP, progesterone, tranexamic, mefenamic, but without any improvement. She has 3 children and has been sterilized. I think by now you all have decided in your brain why the hell she has to keep her uterus, no? Her last cervical smear was 2 years previously and was normal. So smear is also normal. She had a surgery for breast cancer 4 years ago. So she had breast cancer. Her pelvic scan shows no uterine abnormalities. Her endometrial sampling is normal. See, I told you, know, I want to do endometrial sampling to rule out endometrial cancer and endometrial hyperplasias. They have done endometrial sampling, which is normal. Actually, if I would have given this question and I've asked you what is the next step, your answer should be endometrial sampling, right? What would you offer her as a further step of treatment? Endometrial ablation, expectant management awaiting the menopause, hysterectomy, injectable long-acting progestogens, LNG releasing IUS system. Think and answer. I'll be just switching the charging. Do we require required to knock out her uterus, or can I? This is a very beautiful question, guys. And in gynec, it is mainly about 4 or 5 hormones which we go on playing here and there. Actually, you all, easiest answer for all of you and attractive answer for all of you is hysterectomy. You know what I'll do? I am removing the option of hysterectomy. Then you answer. I am removing the option of hysterectomy. I want you people to answer now. Okay, I get the answer of A and B. Can I ask you, why are you not going with E? LNG-IUS is locally acting. Is locally acting, and what does it do? It causes complete atrophy of endometrium. Post six months, it leads to atrophy of endometrium and complete amenorrhea. Instead of your all stupid this OCPs, POPs, always LNG-IUS stands out like a hero. Okay, but I cannot give LNG-IUS here. Who can answer me? Why I can't give LNG-IUS here? See, I'm going through a lot of drills so that I incorporate maximum concepts in you. This is not like a single question. There are 4 or 5 aspects into this. Dr. Kool, can you tell why are we not giving LNG-IUS here? I'll be extremely happy, and if it is a live class, I think whoever answers this will get a chocolate. Yes, it's a virtual class. Excellent, Shruti V. So a virtual chocolate to you. She is having history of breast cancer. LNG-IUS is contraindicated in patients with history of breast and ovarian cancer. That's how your brain should be working. You know, every option you have to think this. So, and every option ruling out. So that's how your clinical questions are framed. Okay. So ideally, if this question didn't have breast cancer, I would have gone with LNG-IUS. But as she has breast cancer, and in breast cancer, LNG-IUS is contraindicated, I will not give LNG-IUS. Okay. Now, she has been symptomatic from 2 years. So I cannot tell, Amma, please wait for another 2 years. She'll not even see my face. This doctor has gone mad. She's just asking me to wait. I've been suffering from 2 years. If in clinical this patient comes to me, I will go for hysterectomy, guys. There is no doubt. But this is not clinical. This is just MCQ, right? So the preferable method we can do is endometrial ablation. So you usually have 2 layers of endometrium. You have 2 layers, stratum basale and stratum functionalis. Stratum basale and stratum functionalis. Functionalis is the one which is shedding every month. Basale is the one which is regenerating the functionalis. Okay. And in endometrium ablation, I damage or I burn this basal layer. And once the basal layer is... And once this basal layer is burnt, it no more regenerates the endometrium. It no more regenerates the endometrium. And that's how there won't be any more problem of excess bleeding or anything. See, I don't require to go for hysterectomy because why am I not going to hysterectomy? Now, you might have a question to me. Okay, why are you not going with hysterectomy? Why do you want to do endometrial ablation? I obviously know and I 100% agree with you. Why am I not going with hysterectomy is... because on endometrial biopsy, endometrium is normal. When endometrium is normal, why do you want to knock out the entire uterus? Just burn the endometrium so that she doesn't get excess bleeding. When you can do a simpler surgery to treat the disease, why do you want to go for a major surgery? Endometrial ablation is a simple surgery. So that's why I prefer to go for endometrial ablation. Anyway, I'm not scared that she's land up in cancer. Okay. Dr. Kool, chocolate is my way of appreciation. Anyway, we are not going to give chocolates virtually also, don't worry. Right, I hope you all understood the previous question, and any queries you can definitely ask me. So let's go to the next question. And more of the questions I tried to keep, you know, lot of thinking, so that when we practice the best, I always believe when you try to do the best, we will definitely get more better way of approaching the exams also. 18-year-old national gymnastics champion is referred to you. She experiences long periods of secondary amenorrhea. She only has 2 to 3 periods each year. So in the entire 12 months, only 2 to 3 periods. I actually tell lucky, no? She's training for coming Olympics. This is before Corona. But her GP advised her to visit you because she's worried about her menstrual cycles. She also suffers backache. Her BMI is 16. What will you offer her? Okay, guys, first, number one, is her BMI normal? Yes, Pavan, you're correct. Ablation leads to Asherman syndrome. That is adhesions of the anterior and posterior wall. I'm okay even she gets Asherman because I want to have a state of amenorrhea. Very good. Excellent. Okay, so I was asking you, what is the BMI 16 normal? BMI 16 is suggestive of excellent, Mansi. So BMI 16 is suggestive of low, undernutrition. Undernutrition. What is normal BMI? Normal BMI is 18 to 25, right? 24.9 to be precise. 25 to 29.9 is overweight. Above 30 is obesity. When she gets only 2 or 3 cycles in a year, we call it as oligomenorrhea. She is getting very infrequent cycles, right? Now, what might be the reason for her infrequent cycles? What will you offer her? Let's take it up. Let's wait for the answer. I have some more points which you have to answer me in the question. What might be her reason for oligomenorrhea? Who can answer me? What is the... Okay. Low weight is her reason for oligomenorrhea. Why does low weight or low BMI leads to oligomenorrhea? Can anybody be more precise? So normally, from the hypothalamus, you have pulsatile GnRH. This pulsatile GnRH will act on the pituitary to produce FSH and LH, which will go act on the ovary to produce estrogen plus progesterone. And this is called as HPO axis. Okay. And who maintains this pulsatility of GnRH is leptin. We require minimum 18% body fat. We require minimum 18% body fat in order to produce enough leptin to cause pulsatility of GnRH. Apart from leptin, the another one which produces pulsatility of GnRH is kisspeptin. Excellent. Leptin is produced from the adipose tissues. So as there is low adipose tissue and low leptin in this patient, the pulsatility of GnRH is lost. As pulsatility of GnRH is lost, no FSH and LH. So that's why she's having oligomenorrhea or very less frequent cycles. Understood? Now, she is an athlete. She doesn't want to get pregnant or something now, but she just want to have regular cycles. So what is the best thing I can do for her to have a regular cycles? I can give her cyclical OCPs. When I give her cyclical OCPs, so these will be for 21 days. For 21 days, you will have estrogen and progesterone. And after 21 days, when you withdraw the estrogen and progesterone, she'll have the menstruation. So every 21 days, she'll have her cycle. So we can offer her cyclical OCP. We can offer her cyclical OCP. Okay. Did you all understand the concept of secondary amenorrhea? Athletes having secondary amenorrhea? Same concept. So whenever you have low fat, like eating disorders, like anorexia, bulimia, they'll also have amenorrhea. On the contrary to this, if they're obese, if a child is obese, if you have a thin girl, she will not have her menstruation started early. So she might land up in delayed puberty. In contrary, if you have an obese girl, what will happen if you have an obese girl? Obese girls will start menstruating early, right? They can have precocious puberty, not exactly precocious, but the menstruation would have started early, like in obese girls. Next question. A 35-year-old woman who is para 2 plus living 1 has presented with secondary amenorrhea for past 10 months and complains of weight gain. She has increased 2 dress sizes over the last year. Very bad, right? Pelvic examination was normal. TVS shows increased AFC and increased ovarian volume. What is the best treatment option for her? Clomiphene citrate for induction of ovulation, ovarian drilling, metformin for regulation of insulin metabolism, withdrawal bleed every 3 to 4 months. Choose the most appropriate answer. First and foremost, think what is the diagnosis here. Just a minute. What is the diagnosis, guys? So secondary amenorrhea for past 10 months. So there is amenorrhea. There is increased ovarian volume. There is weight gain also. And there is increased AFC, antral follicular count. What is your diagnosis? Pregnancy. Okay, I think you are okay in thinking that it can be a pregnancy actually. But in pregnancy, why will antral follicle count increase? Excellent, Shruti. This is a case of PCOD. So now I'll speak some more concepts here. Instead of answering this way, I'll speak some concepts here. Normally, in folliculogenesis, what does this increased antral follicle count means? I'll speak that. Nobody can shake you in the gynec. Gynec is so easy. only till you understand the concepts, I think that will be a little difficult. But after you understand the concepts, it's damn easy. So primordial follicle will become primary follicle. Primary follicle will become secondary. Secondary will become antral, that is fluid-filled follicle. This antral-filled follicle will become the dominant follicle. Okay, this is called as folliculogenesis. Guys, you all know this follicular phase and luteal phase, no? In menstrual cycle, precisely in the ovarian cycle, from where to where you are having? Is it from primordial to dominant or something else? Nobody can shake you in the gynec. Gynec is so easy. Okay. In ovarian cycle, from where to where you have the growth? Is it from primordial to dominant or is it different? In ovarian cycle, in follicular phase. I'm waiting for you people to answer. Okay, I have one of the answers from primordial to dominant. Okay, I'm waiting for some more answers. I want you have to have an active participation. From primary. Dominant follicle is also called as Graafian follicle. This is the one which ovulates. So in follicular phase, after ovulation, it is the luteal phase, right? But in follicular phase, from which follicle develops is my question. Yes, what is your answer, Shashi, Chakri, Lakshmi, Madhubala? Okay, see how we have to develop the simple matlab, actually this is something which is always there, but to be frank, most of the time we miss this point. So I tell you one simple thing here, and a very 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 important thing. Your follicular phase is not from primordial to dominant. Your follicular phase is not from primordial to dominant. Your follicular phase, which you're having in the menstrual cycle, the 14 days, is only from antral follicle to dominant follicle. Is only from antral follicle to dominant follicle. And this is FSH dependent. What do I mean by this? If I have FSH, antral follicle will become dominant follicle. If I don't have FSH, antral follicle will not become dominant follicle. So if I have no FSH, I'll have no ovulation. Okay. From primordial to antral follicle, it is FSH independent. It is FSH independent. You don't require FSH for its growth. Now in PCOS, there is FSH to LH ratio is 1:3. FSH to LH ratio is 1:3. Just give me a minute. I'm actually having a little problem with my son. Class Right. So in PCOS, FSH to LH ratio is 1:3. So as there is no FSH, antral follicle to dominant follicle will not develop. Antral follicle to dominant follicle will not develop. Antral follicle to dominant follicle will not develop. But from primordial follicle to antral follicle can develop because it is FSH independent. That's why in PCOS patients, you have multiple antral follicles. You have multiple antral follicles. Don't you know the description? Pearl of chain appearance. And PCOS is a misnomer. It is not polycystic. It is polyfollicular. There are more follicles. And all these are antral follicles which are arrested and waiting for FSH. If I have an FSH, they'll rupture. Did you understand this concept? And to call it as PCOS, you have Rotterdam's criteria. You have Rotterdam's criteria. So what is this Rotterdam's criteria? Rotterdam's criteria is 2 out of 3 should be positive. That is, they should have oligo or amenorrhea. They should have more than 12 follicles of 2 to 9 mm size. Or ovarian volume more than 10 ml or clinical or biochemical hyperandrogenism. Clinical or biochemical hyperandrogenism. Clinical or biochemical hyperandrogenism. Okay, these are the 2 out of 3. And actually, you also have a recent guideline that is ESHRAE criteria. ESHRAE criteria is 2018, which is also very much same. This Rotterdam's is 2003. ESHRAE is new 2018. Only change in ESHRAE is it's more than 20 follicles. It's not more than 12. It's more than 20 follicles according to ESHRAE. That's the only change which you have in the ESHRAE criteria. Okay. So if you go back, so this is a case of PCOS because it fulfills the 2 out of 3. What are the 2 out of 3? Weight gain is not a criteria. Amenorrhea is one criteria. Increased ovarian volume is second criteria. And increased antral follicle count is also one. If these both come under second criteria. So 2 out of 3 are positive. So this is a PCOS. Now PCOS, you treat according to the symptom. There is no generalized way of treating PCOS. Treating of the PCOS is according to the symptoms. Here, did she tell that she wants to conceive here? No, she already is completed. She has kids. And they didn't mention they want to conceive. So I will not give her clomiphene for induction of ovulation. Why do you want to drill her ovary just like that when she doesn't want to conceive? So it won't be ovarian drilling. Metformin for regulation of insulin metabolism. But did they give that there is increased insulin? Yes, they do have. 50% of the PCOS patients do have increased insulin. But they should mention that there is insulin resistance. When there is insulin resistance, we give metformin. Especially we give metformin, it helps in weight loss, but it also helps in ovulation. Now here I'm not bothered about ovulation, so that's also gone. So as she has completed her family and she has PCOS, I tend to see many such patients. What I can do for them, just give every 3 to 4 months withdrawal bleed so that she has a regular, she has periods and it there won't be heavy bleeding to her. So withdrawal bleed every 3 to 4 months is the best which you can advise her. You can, it depends on your question. If they didn't mention follow Rotterdam's only, if they very clearly mentions ESHRAE 2018, then you go with the ESHRAE. Otherwise follow Rotterdam's 2003 only, okay? So the answer here is withdrawal bleed every 3 to 4 months as she is asymptomatic. As she is completed her family and she's not, they didn't mention that she is willing for pregnancy. She didn't come to you with infertility. So that's why the best treatment I can give is withdrawal bleed every 3 to 4 months. So you have to treat PCOS according to their symptoms. I'll tell you the symptoms wise treatment also. If you have a PCOS, young woman who is just born, young or old woman, young or any woman who has come to you with irregular cycles. If a patient comes to you with irregular cycles, you have to just regularize her cycles. Regularization of cycles can be by either giving OCPs or withdrawal bleed every 45 days. Means every 45 days you give up 5 days of progesterone and then remove it. Every 45 days. Okay. And if you have patient coming to you with hirsutism, PCOS patient bothered about hirsutism, you have to give OCPs containing ciproterone acetate. Ciproterone acetate. And if you have PCOS patient coming to you with infertility, then give ovulation induction with letrozole. If you have your PCOS patient with insulin resistance, then you give metformin. So those many ways of different management we have. Okay. So management depends on what symptom they have come to you. What symptom they have come to you. But principal management is weight loss. Principal management is weight loss. Letrozole is a ovulation, is an aromatase inhibitor, and this is the first line of ovulation induction for infertility with PCOS and obesity. Both of them, it is letrozole is the first line. So guys, any doubts till here? I would like to listen from all of you. Any doubts for till here? Okay, so Mansi, if you're asking me why the answer is give her ovulation, give her withdrawal bleeding every 3 to 4 months is because she didn't come to me for infertility. She mainly came with amenorrhea problem. So I would like to regularize her cycle, at least 4 cycles in 1 year, more than enough. So that's why I'm giving her withdrawal bleeding every 3 to 4 months. What do we do in the withdrawal bleeding? Withdrawal bleeding may, see, Manu, she didn't get her cycles for 2 months. So what I'll do, I'll give her 5 days of progesterone. Which progesterone? You can use any progesterone. We preferably use medroxyprogesterone acetate. You give 5 days of progesterone. So it is like you're giving progesterone for maintaining the endometrium. 5 to 7 days of medroxyprogesterone acetate and then withdraw. She'll get her periods because in PCOS, it's mainly anovulatory cycles. So when you give progesterone and support the endometrium and when you withdraw, they'll start bleeding. So 5 to 7 days of medroxyprogesterone acetate and withdraw, she'll start bleeding. Okay? Right, I hope you understood, Mansi. Okay, what is this? What is this picture? Bartholin cyst, Gartner cyst, cystocele, vulval inclusion cyst. For weight gain, she has to walk. No drugs for weight gain. She doesn't, she has so much time. She can, she has to lose her weight natural way. So walk or modified nutrition therapy. Excellent. This is not Bartholin cyst. This is not Bartholin cyst. Bartholin cyst will be present in junction of upper 2/3 and lower 1/3. It is a posterolateral cyst. Bartholin cyst is a posterolateral cyst. This is Gartner's cyst. Anterior vaginal wall cyst. Anterior vaginal wall cyst which is dense, shiny, and no rugosities. It is nothing but the Gartner's cyst. So this one which you are seeing is the Gartner's cyst, which is, it is dense, it is shiny, and there are no rugosities. Okay, and it has well-defined margins. It has well-defined margins. Whereas cystocele also act as a differential diagnosis for this. In cystocele, you will have rugosities. It will be reducible. It will not have well-defined margins. What is this Gartner cyst? What is Gartner cyst? It is a remnant of Wolfian duct. Remnant of Wolfian duct will result in Gartner's duct. And that will result in Gartner's cyst. Proximal remnant of mesonephric tubule. Proximal remnant of mesonephric tubule will give rise to anybody? Epophoron. Distal remnant of mesonephric tubule. Distal remnant of mesonephric tubule will give rise to paraphoron. Blockage of paraphoron will result in par ovarian cyst. Blockage of paraphoron will result in par ovarian cyst. And remnant of mesonephric duct will result in Gartner's duct. So normally Mullerian duct will give rise to uterus and all. Wolfian duct or the mesonephric duct will regress. And when it regresses, it leaves back some remnants. So these are those. Okay. So that was for today's discussion. So before I schedule the next class, I would like to listen some points from you people. That is, shall I keep the standard of questions same? Standard of questions same or intermediate? I'll not ask easy. Shall I keep it same or more difficult? Or little less difficult. So that was not Bartholin cyst. That was not Bartholin cyst. Okay. And see, what I did, if you observe, the first session which I took ops. The second session which I took gynec. So probably I've been given another 3 hours where I can do. So probably another OBS, another gynec, and one I can take mixed. Or I can, okay, you want a topic wise. I think we can beautifully frame topic wise also. These are all FMG based only. Don't be in a misconception because I know if you have not seen the FMG 2020 paper, so this is the pattern which you're going to see. And suddenly when you see in the FMG 2020, this pattern of questions, you get to scared. So this is more of the FMG itself. Okay. You have to train yourself to this pattern. Otherwise it's difficult. Okay. Right. So I'll try to plan if possible topic wise and I'll send the topics. So I have 3 more sessions. I'll try to do some topic wise and send you topics that can be implemented. Right. I'll incorporate some image based questions also. Yes. I know last time we got many images. Yes. I'll incorporate more images. Okay. So thank you guys. Keep studying. All the best. Any queries, always feel free to ask me. My name is Ramya Sri. I teach obstetrics and gynecology. So in case if you want to ask me any queries, you can search my name on the Telegram group. And yes, Telegram. And yes, you can ask me queries. So next question is, next thing is, what is Nepothian cyst? Nepothian cysts are of no clinical significance and they are a part of infection. They're just seen on the ectocervix. Nepothian cysts are very commonly seen on the ectocervix. These are of no clinical significance. Usually, even if we see some Nepothian cysts, we don't do anything. They're just blocked glands. Okay. Questions about cancers. Okay, as you have asked me the topic, can we do next class oncology? So what you do is you all read and come oncology. I'll put questions from cervical cancers. I'll put questions from ovarian cancer. I'll put questions from endometrial cancer. And I'll also put questions from vulval cancer because you got question on vulval cancer. And GTN, gestational trophoblastic neoplasia. These five cancers. So done. Tomorrow it's not my class. So thank you guys. All the best. Keep studying. Very good, Revis George. Yes, ABC intra extra poda. That is the mnemonic which I have for the staging of ovarian cancer. Correct. So next class we will do oncology. And then you can tell me what further you want me to do. So you decide, I'll follow that, whatever you people tell me. Okay. Thank you guys. Thank you.